For 47 years, Joe Biden viciously attacked black Americans.
Honk if you think it's a bunch of malarkey.
If you believe in democracy, you want every vote counted.
Trump's a loser.
This guy is a stone-cold phony.
For both presidential candidates, all roads led to Pennsylvania.
Love me, women of the suburbs.
It's time to stand up. It's time to take back our democracy.
In Pittsburgh, Obama's former vice president revealed who really pulls the strings.
I work for Lady Gaga.
The Biden campaign borrowing some star power for its final pitch.
Now is the time to show up and vote like this country depends on it, because it does.
And while Biden brought out the big names, Trump settled for insulting some big names in Biden's hometown of Scranton.
Lady Gaga is not too good. I can tell you plenty of stories about Lady Gaga and John Bon Jovi. Every time I see him, he kisses my ass. They got Beyonce and they got Jay-Z, right, Jay-Z? And he started using the F word, you remember? How about LeBron? I felt badly for LeBron. When they don't respect our flag, nobody wants to watch. Nobody.
But behind the theatrics and threats...
Don't tell anybody, but let me wait till a little bit after the election.
Darker narrative is taking shape. Trump further sowing the seeds for post-election violence.
Governor, please don't shoot. Because we're all watching.
The National Guard rolling into cities across the country while shop owners were preparing for the coming storm.
Never seen such a thing. And I've been living in this country for 45 years. This is unbelievable.
Nobody should be scared to be in this area.
It's a ghost town. It's really, really shocking.
Ahead of arguably its most consequential choice, America looks less like a free and fair democracy and more like a battleground.
Elizabeth Newman is the former Assistant Secretary of Counterterrorism and Threat Prevention with the Department of Homeland Security. She quit that role when she realised, despite being a lifelong Republican, she could no longer work for the president, who she describes as chaotic and toxic. Thanks for joining us tonight, Elizabeth. Take us back to your time working in the administration. What was it like working for Trump?
Well, you kind of covered it. It was a lot of chaos. It was a lot of attempts to try to educate him on the threats that our country was facing. And he just wasn't interested in doing the job. He seemed more interested in things that stroked his ego, like campaign rallies or making money. So we found that there's an upside to that. If he ignored something you were trying to do, you usually can make progress, but there are certain issues in government where you do need that presidential leadership, and domestic terrorism was one of them. And then you have another example of too much interference, as we've seen in the U.S.'s handling of COVID-19.
I thought it was interesting reading you talk about how it went from being able to guide him to your role being just to try and stop him from doing something catastrophic.
That's right. In 2017, many of us came in thinking he will learn. He will, like many people, get into the office and be in awe of the responsibility on your shoulders to be able to care and steward the United States. And that just didn't happen. There was a period of time in 2017 where you had strong cabinet members that were able to channel him in the right direction. And slowly but surely, he pushed all of those officials out. He would ask us to do things that were illegal. When you would tell him no, he would get frustrated and tell you to do it anyway. There are anecdotes from some of my former colleagues about how he offered, encourage them to go ahead and do the illegal act, and he would make sure that they were pardoned. So there is definitely a streak in him that many of us felt was going against our oath. And that oath of office is not to a person, not to the president, it's to the Constitution. And now the people that remain, the people that have come in, most of those people either choose not to brief him on bad news or just agree to whatever he says. It's rather scary from a national security perspective. It's one thing to make bad policy decisions on economics. It's a whole other thing to be making bad policy decisions on things that could lead us to war, or in the case of COVID, are causing more deaths than are necessary.
You mentioned domestic terrorism before. You speak about how when you returned in 2017 to work at the administration, you just noticed things had changed, things within the country had changed, and that there is a white supremacist problem. Can you unpack that a little bit for us and what you believe that the president is doing to fan the flames in a way?
That rise has been ongoing for about 10 years, but it really started to peak in 2017 into 2018. We had a pretty significant attack at a synagogue in Pittsburgh. And then sadly, we saw Christchurch in March 2019. This trend existed before Donald Trump, but he exacerbated it, and it really was incumbent upon him to acknowledge that and change his ways, and he patently refused. In fact, we were not allowed to talk about it in terms of domestic terrorism in the White House. We were told to talk about all of our programmatic efforts as violence prevention efforts. But it's been a pretty prominent theme of his campaign to talk about left-wing violence out of Antifa. And what we've seen over the summer and into the fall is that a number of FBI indictments have come down, and all of them are associated with right-wing extremist groups or ideologies. So there's a lot of disinformation in this space, and it's created a lot of confusion in our country, which makes it even harder to go after the threat if people don't even know where the threat is coming from.
So given your expertise in radical politics and given a lot of the discussions of potential violence in the aftermath of this election, do you see that as a real threat that is somehow connected to what you're describing?
Sadly, I am concerned about potential violence on the other side of the election. Both sides are absolutely convinced that their team's going to win and somebody's going to lose. So two groups of angry people, you can just have spillover violence. It's a very dry tinderbox right now. It doesn't take much of a spark. The second concern we have is that we may see additional attempts at violence like we saw in the George Floyd protest, where you have individuals and groups that have an ideology called accelerationism. And these individuals believe that there will someday be a civil war, a war, as some people hold to it, that it will be a race war. Some people just think it's going to be a war to overturn the U.S. government. But their accelerationist ideology is that they look for opportunities to accelerate the societal collapse. The third group are tend to be right-wing extremists who, in the vein of Timothy McVeigh, would love to conduct a large-scale attack. It requires more planning, it usually requires obtaining weapons, and it allows law enforcement more time to identify and thwart the threat. So I'm hopeful that we won't see any of that, but I do think the other two categories, I do think those are likely. It's a very volatile situation for law enforcement.
Let's hope worst-case scenario doesn't play out, Elizabeth. We appreciate your insight tonight. It's been fascinating having a chat. Thanks for your time.
Thank you for having me.